We'll start. Hi, welcome. Good evening. My name is Shuman Basar. I'm one of the co-curators of this exhibition, World of Madeleine Riesendorp, with Stefan Truby. Gives me great pleasure, also on behalf of Francesca Ferguson, the director of the museum, to welcome you all here this evening during Museumnacht. I'm going to keep this super short because I'm mainly here just to introduce the artist this evening, who's going to share some of her stories about her own life that is really what is on show in this exhibition. The World of Madeleine Riesendorp is perhaps more accurately the ex-secret world of Madeleine Riesendorp. This is sort of 40 years of paintings, of drawings, of collecting, of game designing, of filmmaking, and that for a long time had been, in a sense, partly through her own intention, but also maybe partly through other circumstances, not available for the public to enjoy and to experience. And it's been a great pleasure that Stefan and I have been able, over the last couple of years, to convince Madeleine that this extraordinary archive of hers, most of which has existed in her apartment in North London, the same apartment that she moved to in 1976, having spent 5 years in America with her husband, Rem Koolhaas, researching this extraordinary history and fiction and fantasy of New York and America, which many of you will know culminated in Rem Koolhaas's book, Delirious New York, which is a kind of retroactive manifesto for the city, the cover of which features one of Madeleine's, or perhaps Madeleine's most famous an iconic image, which is over here, which is called Flagrant Délit, which shows the Chrysler Building and the Empire State Building caught post-coital with a discarded Goodyear blimp cast in the middle of the bed, and the Rockefeller Center, the RCA Building, has crashed in and has found these two skyscrapers literally caught in the act. And this is the one, perhaps the image and the other images that were made around that time in the mid-70s that Madeleine's name is most closely related to. But as you can see, walking through the exhibition here, there's much, much more to Madeleine's world and to her work than these extraordinary images. And I think hers is a practice that I think throws up a whole number of really interesting issues about what it might mean to be an artist and what an artist's relationship is to medium, is to the kind of their family, to their private life, to their public life, to notions of ambition, to notions of public exhibition and private exhibition. And so it's been a really amazing, I think, opportunity and pleasure for Stefan and I and the various institutions that have helped to make this come together and who've shared in the opportunity of showing this work, which started at the Architectural Association in London and then went to Berlin, and we showed some of it in Venice. And it gives us great pleasure to bring it here in Basel, in this amazing space, which almost feels like either it was designed for the show or the show was designed for it, but it really works quite perfectly. So I think I'm just going to hand over to Madeleine now. And we had a talk at the AA just under a year ago, and we needed a title. And the title was simply Wonderful Things. And I think there's there's something, and I talked about this yesterday a little bit, about the power of humor, the power of the joke, to maybe say things about ourselves, about the world, that perhaps can't be expressed in any other way. And certain things happen, certain things are allowed to be said when they're told as jokes, when they're told humoristically, that if they were told in any other way, we simply maybe wouldn't be able to believe it or take it seriously. So I think this whole idea of what Madelon has said about taking non-serious things very, very seriously, for me anyway, has become the frame through which to look at this this amazing archive, this amazing world of work here. And hopefully Madelon will be able to shed some personal anecdotes. So please welcome with me Madelon Vriesendonck.
Thank you all very much for your generosity to come here and to look at my strange collections. I'll just read you something I wrote. I'll make it quite short, but I will explain to you a few things about being me. To give you an idea of where I'm coming from, I'll read you something I wrote about Holland. Holland being nowhere. A country full of principled people with unrelenting good taste. Post-war Holland was very moralistic. We were part of a generation that was rebelling against the limitations of that era, paving the way for a type of post-moralism we have now. People like Andy Warhol and the Venturis were exploring popular culture. In America, where bad taste was the norm. Bad taste was one of the liberating features in our stay in America. It was directly related to a multicultural society. In New York, oh, wait a minute. Charlie, being nowhere is not here. Okay, I'll read you being nowhere later. In New York, we did, in 1972, we did research on Delia's New York. We started to collect New York books and postcards. I was particularly interested in the most devastatingly sad places, motels, lonely highways, one red car, tunnels, inside a diner, the electric chair, which I called the wish you were here cards, cowboys, racist cards, etc., wherever American history was still raw and smarting. Souvenirs are a great warts and all revelation about a country. Even in their jolliest attempts to present the glory days, you're always on the precipice of an abyss with souvenirs. A giant step of memory lapse, clinging on to yesterday's future. So Delia's New York and collecting were parallel, one informed and inspired the other. My paintings were done independently, inspired by New York, Rem, books and postcards. Becoming a tourist was important to us then. We thrived on the beauty you see in things obscure, the inspiration you get from not knowing, speculating freely. I didn't speak English very well, so I once said thanks for your hostility after a nice meal. The scale and speed of New York was overpowering. It went deep into our subconscious. I would dream about it. In one dream, all the buildings of New York were laid flat on a grid and they all fitted together like a puzzle. The book Delirious New York taps into experience of being in a city. At times, a humorous description of the life and times of buildings. The exhilarating ideas and plans of the excitement they caused. The cover with the buildings in bed together was ridiculous then and still is, a joke, but a serious one. These buildings were supermodels of the day, dressed up to the hilt, showing off. In serious message was wasted on most academics in New York. this serious message. Building in bed together was and is an ultimate bad taste. My friend Terry took the painting to be framed, and the framer said, "We don't frame paintings like this." I was pleased to hear it. So at the time, we occupied the gray area between academia and clowning. This is why this could never be a lecture. Academics give lectures. They question and look for answers. I'm an artist. Artists have answers for which they try to find the right questions. I look around and see things and think, that's an answer to something. What were the questions that forced this object, painting, souvenir, into existence? Einstein said, if the facts don't fit the theory, change the facts. We constantly change the facts to fit the image, the object. I'm interested in the relationship between objects. Toys are a portal to a parallel universe. When you're a child, life is too big for you. So you create imagery, families, your own scaled-down universe, where you have total control over your environment, an alternative, more idyllic world. We all play with scale in drawings and models. Like children, I play with scale. Children have no sense of scale. They go with their toy train to the railway lines and are surprised when it doesn't fit. I was forever trying my doll's clothes on. It was a huge disappointment. Klaas Oldenburg once said that we were doing the same thing, only he was enlarging and I was reducing. As an artist, you can zoom in and out, no need to stick to rules of reality. We can call this playground surrealism. Sorry, I lost my paper. We have to take play seriously. Look at the significance of play. At installing the show, some of the quotes of the object table. You can see here we are taking everything ridiculously seriously. The object archive takes small objects and turns them into cities. A reversal from the paintings that reduces buildings to human scale. The archive has a randomness that reflects human life. In it, you find the accidents of the world, which is a constant cycle of random meetings and happenings. Like New York, all ideologies stand together on a grid. Does it say something about community, people living side by side in their own world, relate to each other or not? The objects in the archive reflect multiculturalism. All cultures are represented, are strangers to each other. And also a statement how today we have to incorporate all cultures into our thinking. I understand this because I have made myself a permanent foreigner. As a foreigner, you're a misplaced person. You misunderstand and you're equally misunderstood. This confusion is crucial to everything I do. It stimulates your imagination to create new interpretations and your own myths. As an outsider, in a sense, you have failed. And that's why I'm interested in failed objects. A failed object has something moving about it. It says something about the ambitions that were never realized. Sometimes its existence is the only thing it has going for it. I started to adopt flawed objects because of my empathy with failure. When an curator came to my studio once, he said, you have an archive. Can you please write about it? And I said, you call it an archive. Great. So this is what I wrote. I had always called it my stuff. So I forced myself to formulate my thoughts on what I was doing. So I read you what I wrote. There are two different archives, started in the 70s. Postcards collections, cities, buildings, roads, bridges, tunnels, mountains, trees, early collage, motels, interiors, Americana, Egypt, and Europe. The second is installation of objects, buildings, people, animals, body parts, etc. I call my collection a city since it's constantly expanding and changing and incomplete. I was forced to rearrange and reshape my city when it grew beyond its limits. I classified the collection into subjects and separated them into smaller groups, losing some of the original arbitrariness. Now small clusters are migrating to other areas to settle and grow, to be dismantled and rearranged again when necessary. Parts are used in sets or scenes. My aim is to put together a wide range of incongruous and diverse items from different cultures, which through sheer accumulations change their status. At its best, the archive is a microculture clash, a visual surprise, the least plausible depiction of an idea, with examples of accidental or calculated imperfections, objects of muddled origins, sometimes heavy with symbolic pretext, rejects from an outdated or never fashionable artistic order, reinterpreted, misinterpreted, bizarre or mysterious. The objects that most miss their targets are often the most irresistible. For instance, the Indian Minnie Mouse in regional dress, Father Christmas with wings, a skeletal scorpion, etc. In short, freaks of culture. Surrounded by it, I feel like a tourist who has been given the wrong directions, misunderstood them, and ended up in the right place. With this archive, I hope to add in an inventive way to interpretation, speculation, conjecture, and random connections, like a gene multiplying uncontrollably, a nanoconception on a grand scale, a memory bank of scrambled issues. I would like to gather the whole collection into one space and organize an earthquake or volcanic eruption so that at a later date, like 400 years, it can be exhumed and perhaps create the confusion or the certainty relevant to that future culture. One question could be, how do others experience your archive? One friend thought it was like walking into a collage. My cleaner said, I'm not dusting that. Sorry, I lost one bit of my lecture. Should I read it? I was going to read you something about Holland, and it's called Nowhere, to realize where I grew up and what the sensibilities were of that the people who lived in that country or live in that country. A man who asked his friend Spike Milligan, "Where are you?" was giving the answer, "Nowhere, somewhere." You always have to be somewhere. This doesn't apply to Holland. In Holland, you can be nowhere. In fact, there's a lot of nowhere in Holland. You can be in a place, look around, and it's exactly the same as somewhere else in Holland. A flat green plain, a miniature skyline, and the horizon with several spires pointing up, like sharpened pencils, a testimony to the multiple religions Holland traditionally accommodated. Some houses scattered about, one interchangeable with the next, for lack of compelling features. A few trees, a moat, a fence, and there it ends. Except it doesn't. It never ends. The landscape unfolds with unrelenting sameness, mile after mile. When finally you come to a forest, you can be pretty sure that behind it, this flat green will appear again with provocative nothingness before your eyes. We, the Dutch, have learned to love it, just as we've learned to love potatoes. To counteract the destructive boredom of colorlessness, we filled our Dutch nursery coloring books with screaming primal color crayons. It made us feel we were somewhere doing something. You always ended up with a red cloud, a blue cow, and a yellow windmill. My sister had a boyfriend who came along one summer to our rented cottage in the north of Holland in the middle of this unyielding green. My family consisted of my mother, my stepfather and his son, two older sisters, and my brother and me. It was raining with a constancy typical to Dutch summers. My brother would stand in front of the window days on end and sing his dismal little song, a dissonant version of I Can Hear the Rain. Oh, how it's raining, how it's raining. I can hear it from my warm bed. I hear the rain singing. How no one notices this sad state of affairs. In this miserable collective family mood, we had blazing arguments. whose turn is it to peel the potatoes? As families invariably prey on outsiders to point out the ills of the world, we collectively turn to the unlucky boyfriend, suitably named Martin Fierce. He, realizing immediately that this was not just a potato peeling issue, refused to comply. A family row ensued, wholly inappropriate to the scale of the matter and the setting. My brother stayed silently at the window, his eyes glazing over, as if to soft focus the racket around him. Martin took his stuff and stormed out the door. My sister was praised extensively for letting him go. It is notoriously difficult to storm out into nowhere and end up somewhere. So he walked the mercilessly flat grasslands about an hour. Without looking back, we checked. Every now and then, someone would go to the window and we would call out, "Is he still there?" And the answer would invariably be, "Yes, I can still see him." Or, "He's still out there." And then, "I can still see his head." When finally he disappeared, there was no sign of relief, just a muted acknowledgement that nothing had been achieved and nothing lost. His lack of imprint on the landscape had left the pasture more hostile and more horizontal than ever before.
Thank you very much. We hope you enjoy the exhibition, and thanks for your attention. Thank you.